the Upanishad series. Disidentification with the mind. The whole process of the mind is to disidentify with the mind. For this, you have to be committed to life moment to moment. Mind is vacillation, very indecisive. It cannot be in the moment and cannot make the decision. Disappearance of the mind is the beginning of meditation. It is said that there are 90,000 subtle gestures that are part of the mind. And when you become aware of these subtle gestures, you have overcome the mind. Mind is always in that space of to be or not to be. If you really want to grow into maturity and really want to know what this life is all about, do not vacillate, do not waver, commit to life. Involve yourself with life, get committed to it, but do not remain a mere spectator. Do not go on thinking whether to do or not to do. Should I do this or that? You can vacillate your whole life, and the more you vacillate, the more trained you become in the process of vacillation, and this process continues. And in the process of meditation to attain, you have to be flowing with life and do not allow the mind to waver. Life is for those who know how to commit by saying yes to everything. Life is for those who know how to commit by saying yes to everything. How to say no to something decisively. There is an Indian no and there is a Canadian no. If you are serving food to an Indian person, he says, no, I'm not hungry, that's okay. But if you insist a second time, you ask him, he will say, no, that's okay, I'm not hungry. A third time they say, okay, if you are insisting so much, I can try a little bit. Although he is not hungry, but he is waiting for a second or the third time you ask him. But a Canadian no is a stern no. No, that's it. I am not hungry. So life is for those who know how to commit by saying yes to everything. Yes to something. How to say no to something decisively. Categorically, once you have categorically said yes or no to something, then you can take a jump. Then you can dive deep into the ocean. People are just sitting on the fence. Millions of people are fence sitters, this way or that. Just waiting for the opportunity to come, and opportunity will never come because it has already come, it is there. My suggestion is that even if sometimes it happens that you commit to wrong thing, even then it is good to commit. Commitment is important and good, because the day you will know it is wrong, you can go out of it. At least you would have learned one thing, that it is wrong, and never to get into anything like that again. You are driving on the road, you are not afraid, you miss your destination, you can take a turn from the next road or take a U-turn and come back. Just as these days most of the vehicles have GPS system installed, this GPS system is always installed into your being, is always there. Only thing is this, you have to learn to commit to itself. And once you know how to use the GPS system that has been installed in you, you realize that you have made a mistake. You can take a round turn, about turn, and you can come back and continue your journey. Commitment is good and is important. It is the basic thing. Because the day you will know it is wrong, you can get out of it. At least you would have learned one thing, that it is wrong, and never to get into anything like that again. It is a great experience, and it will bring you closer to truth. You can use every obstacle as the, instead of using it as a stumbling block, you can use it as a stepping stone. These two words are very close, stumbling block or stepping stone. Why do people vacillate so much? People vacillate, deviate, people waver, because from the very childhood you have been told not to commit any mistakes. This is one of the blunders. If you do not make a mistake, you can, where would you learn? The more one learns from a mistake, the more one grows into maturity. That has been one of the teachings of all the societies all over the world, and this is dangerous and harmful. To teach children to commit as many mistakes as possible. But there is a condition. Do not commit the same mistake over again. If you go on committing the same mistake again, it is not going to help you to learn. A mistake is committed and you learn from it. You missed your road, so the next time when you are driving, you are trying to be cautious, that you do not, you have to be a little more concerned, more careful, that you do not miss your road again. That is all. And they will grow and they will experience more and more once you allow them to make mistakes. But there is one condition. You are giving them an assurance that it is not a problem to make a mistake, to stumble. It is very natural for an infant when he is learning to walk, learning to stand up, how many times he stumbles, he falls down, but he continues to make an effort. And if you observe, the child makes the effort in different ways. If he falls down, he will crawl to somewhere where he can find a support, and holding on to the support, he will stand up. This is the natural instinct which has been given to us. And if you give them the confidence that committing a mistake is not a problem, but make sure do not commit the same mistake again, they will grow and they will experience more and more. They will not vacillate. Otherwise, a trembling always goes on deep within, and time is passing by. It is slipping out of your hands and you are vacillating. Mind is vacillation. Meditation requires being so watchful of the mind that its stupidities, hesitations, tremblings, and its vacillations are cut off. That is the whole purpose of watching. Watching cuts you off. Watch anything in the mind and you are cut off from it. Watching is a sword. It is, if a thought is moving in your mind, you just watch it, and suddenly you will see the thought is there, you are here, and there is no bridge between you and the thought. The bridge is created when you pay attention to a particular thought. It is the bridge that you create between you and the thought. If a thought is moving in your mind, you just watch it, and suddenly you will see the thought is there, you are here, but there is no bridge between the two. Do not watch and you become identified with the thought. You become it. Watch and you are not it. Mind possesses you because you have forgotten how to watch. You have to learn the art of watching. Just looking at the rose flower, watch it. Or at the stars, or at the people passing on the road, sit by the side and start watching. You can stand up by the busy corner where cars are passing. You will notice a car passes, then there is no car on the road for a few seconds, then again a few cars passes. This is how the process goes on in the human mind. And then you are sitting by the side and watch. And then slowly and slowly close your eyes, and you will start. With open eyes you was watching traffic moving on the road. With closed eyes you will start moving, start seeing the traffic moving within. Thousands of thoughts, desires, dreams are passing by. It is always like a rush hour, and you have to be constantly into that. Sitting on the bank, just watch as somebody watches a river flowing by, the waves rising and falling on the surface of the ocean. Just watch, and watching you will become aware that you are not it. Just watch, and watching you will become aware that you are not it. Mind is being identified with it, and no mind is being disidentified with it. Do not be a mind, because in fact you are not the mind. You are the watcher. You are the consciousness. Then who are you? If you are not the mind, you are consciousness. You are that watchfulness. You are witnessing. You are that pure observation, that mirror-like quality that reflects everything but never gets identified with anything. Mind is the mirror. The moment you understand, you discover the mirror-like quality of the mind, you have transcended the mind. The mind will not vacillate. Mind will not disturb. Remember, I am not saying that you are conscious. There is a difference. I am not saying that you are conscious. Instead, I am saying you are consciousness. That is your true identity. The day one knows, I am consciousness. Ever expanding consciousness. This is one of the sutras of Isha Upanishad. Isha vasyamidam sarvam yat kinch jagatyam jagat. I am that ever expanding consciousness. The day you come to know that I am consciousness, you have come to know the ultimate, because the moment you know I am consciousness, you also know not only you, but everything is consciousness. But everything is at a different plane. The rocks have their own consciousness. The trees have their own consciousness. The animals have their own level of consciousness, and so are the people. Everyone is conscious in their own way. Consciousness is therefore the multifaceted diamond. The day you realize I am consciousness, you have known the universal truth. You have come to the goal. Socrates says, man, know thyself. One of the hadith says, manarfa nafsahu arfa rabbahu. One who has known himself has known God. This is the first criteria, to know yourself first. As such as you are identified with the mind. And through the mind, whatsoever you will see, because mind is sum total of thoughts. It is the aggregate of thoughts, the resultant. So when you are looking at the world and it's a phenomena through the filter of the mind, it is like the surface of the mirror has become opaque with the layers of the dust. There is so much dust accumulated on the surface of the mirror that the mirror cannot reflect. With thoughts, mind becomes an opaque, a layer of the mirror. It cannot reflect. The criteria to know, to see the world and its objects, everything in its reality, is to know yourself, that you are consciousness. Many times it happens we make our own judgments. I gave you the example of Buddha again and again, and it is worth mentioning as many times as it can be. Every morning Buddha will dress, take his begging bowl, go whichever direction, not decided which direction he will go, whichever direction his feet take him to, he goes there. And as he reaches the crowd, gathers, Buddha begins his sermon. So this morning he went to a village where he was not supposed to go. And as he went, crowd gathered, a man out of the crowd came out and he started abusing Buddha. Buddha did not pay any attention to it. Then he spit on Buddha again, but there was no reaction from Buddha. Why there was no reaction to Buddha? Because Buddha is consciousness. It is the consciousness is operating, which is seeing things beyond time and space. You know the reason why this man has done it. For instance, you have not been able to use your credit cards properly. The balance has accumulated. They are not being serviced. You go, the bank manager calls you and you go. You know the truth that you have not been able to service your credit cards. The bank manager knows. But if someone else goes with you, he will not know the reality. You have to be quietened because you know the reality. In a way, you can say that you can see beyond time and space how the credit card has been misused. Buddha knew what is the reason for this man to act in that manner. But Anand was watching it. He did not know. He only knew this particular moment of Buddha. You remember, before a flower blossoms, it has to go through various stages. So when, before an individual attains, comes to know that he is consciousness, there had been a many a moment when you have stumbled. It is one of those moments that he would have said something to this person and that account is still open. He has to close this account out of consciousness. If he has reacted in that moment, you are keeping the account open. You have to silently watch and listen to it so that it dissolves. So this is where the meditation comes into play. You are conscious. You do not know why this thing is happening. And when Lao Tzu says there can be nothing wrong, the existence is very wise. Existence is very wise, it does never anything wrong. Lao Tzu says, I have reached to the point where I can see nothing wrong can happen. But with your mind you can never find anything happening right. You want this thing to happen and it does not happen. You are full of complaint. When you miss a road, you do not consider it wrong. Someone reminds you, yes, you missed the road. He said, don't worry, I have GPS system and from the next turn, I will take a U-turn and it will give me the direction. The day you realize I am consciousness, you have known the universal truth, you have come to the goal, and you have come to know thyself. That is the teaching of all the Buddha, to know thyself. In different ways and means, they have propagated only one thing, to know thyself. How are you going to know yourself? If mind remains too much and goes on clamoring and clinging around you, you will not hear the truth, because mind is noise, and in the clatter of the noise, in the clamoring of the mind, it will go on clinging to the things which are superficial, and you will not hear the truth. When mind goes on making noise, you will never hear the still small voices within. You have to become disidentified within. Gurdjieff used to say, my whole teaching can be condensed in one word, and that word is disidentification. He is right. Not only his teaching can be condensed into one word, the teaching of all the masters can be condensed into one word, disidentification with the mind. With the noise of the mind, with the continuous process of the thoughts. If there are filters in your mind, and these filters are created by your desires, your lust, greed, and all these things, the light cannot manifest in its truest form. And you go on identifying with it. The moment you disidentified with this process, you enter into a different realm, the realm of consciousness. You come to realize that Aham Brahmasmi, I am ever expanding consciousness. And not only I am ever expanding consciousness, the entire cosmos, everything sentient and insentient, is nothing else but consciousness at different levels. So when you are interacting with a child, you know his level of consciousness is different than yours. You interact with him in a different way. When you are interacting with the rocks, you interact in a different way. The plants, the rivers, the mountains, all are expansion of consciousness. That's why I said ever expanding consciousness. It goes on expanding. Never be identified with the mind. Never be identified with the continuous flow of thoughts, with the clatter of the noise. You will experience a different kind of serenity. You will come to know about the subtle gestures, which according to meditators, there are 90,000 subtle gestures. Slowly and slowly mind becomes aware of these. And then a moment comes in when it explodes into inner silence. Disidentification with the mind is the first step. Disidentify with the mind, the rest will start happening on its own. We are in the season of Easter. Wish you all a holy and happy Easter.